I'm on top of the world, hey. I'm on top of the world, hey. Waiting on this for a while now. Paying my dues to the dirt. I've been waiting to smile, hey. Been holding it in for a while, hey. Take you with me if I can. Been dreaming of this since a child. Good day, aspiring geologists. Today, me and my group will be presenting volcanic massive sulfide deposits. What are VMS deposits? Volcanogenic massive sulfide deposits are one of the richest sources of metals such as copper, lead, and zinc globally. VMS deposits can also produce economic amounts of gold and silver as byproducts of mining in these deposits. Currently, global metal production from VMS deposits account for 22% of zinc, 9.7% of lead, 6% of copper, 8.7% of silver, and 2.2% of gold. Where are VMS deposits found? VMS deposits occur around the globe and often form in clusters or camps following the tectonic plate boundaries and areas of ancient underwater volcanic activity. VMS deposits are forming today on the seafloor and around undersea volcanoes along many mid-ocean ridges and within back-arc basins and fore-arc cliffs. They are predominantly stratiform accumulations of sulfide minerals that precipitate from hydrothermal fluids on or below the seafloor in a wide range of geological settings. They are synonymous with sulfurous plumes called black smokers. They occur within environments dominated by volcanic or volcanic-derived rocks, and the deposits are coeval and coincident with the formation of said volcanic rocks. Mineralization and formation. The geological process that form VMS deposits occur at the depths of the ocean and are associated with volcanic and or sedimentary rocks. Number 1. At sections where the Earth's crust is thin due to faulting or separation of tectonic plates, the magma heats up the ocean floor. Number 2. As the Earth's crust heats up, the ground softens and allows heated magma to escape towards the ocean or crust contact, the early beginning of a volcano in the deposition of minerals into the ocean floor from magma. Also, the heated ground cracks and begins a process that draws in seawater into the crust, which becomes superheated and imbued with minerals. Black and white smokers expel this seawater back to the surface. Number 3. Black and white smokers exhale a mineral-rich plume that spreads out over the ocean floor. As it moves farther and farther away from its heat source, the plume precipitates minerals onto the ocean floor. Over time, the continual activity of the smokers in the mineral-rich plumes create mineralized beds that become VMS deposits. Number 4. With the movement of the Earth's tectonic plates, these mineral-rich beds are transposed and can be found on land that was once underwater. As you can see in this infographic, mineral-rich brines escape from hydrothermal vents. As the mineral brine moves away from the vents, the cooling effect of the water, reduced pressure, and chemical reactions cause copper, zinc, and lead, and other metals from the brine to precipitate onto the ocean floor and, over time, form the lenses and bodies of mineralization. How large are VMS deposits? Current resource and historical production figures from 904 VMS deposits around the world average roughly 17 million tons, of which is approximately 1.7% copper, 3.1% zinc, and 0.7% lead. A few giant mineral deposits greater than 30 million tons and several copper-rich and zinc-rich deposits of median range around 2 million tons skewed averages. Several large VMS camps are known to be larger than 100 million tons. Enormous potential. VMS deposits have the potential for long-term production due to the formation of clusters of deposits or ore lenses in close proximity and the polymetallic nature of the ore. Typically, several deposits feed a central mill, creating economies of scale. Byproduct credits generated from production of different metals enhance the cash cost profile of the mining companies and thus benefit the investors. Volcanogenic massive sulfide deposits are classified into three major types, Kuroko, Beshi, Cyprus, as well as nine minor types, felsic silicastic, felsic, siclastic felsic, bimodal mafic, phyllitic mafic, mafic, Syclastic mafic, batak mafic, and mafic ultramafic. Morphology. Venous deposits have an ideal form of a conical area of highly altered volcanic or volcanogenic sedimentary rock within the feeder zone, which is called the stringer sulfide or stockwork zone, overlain by a mound of massive exhalites and flanked by stratiform exhaustive sulfides known as the apron. The stockwork zone typically consists of vein-hosted sulfides, mostly chalcopyrite, pyrite, and pyroitite, with quartz, chlorite, and lesser carbonates and barite. The mound zone consists of laminated massive to brecciated pyrite, sphalerite, galena, hematite, and barite. The mound can be up to several tens of meters thick and several hundred meters in diameter. Metal zonation. Most famous deposits show metal zonation caused by the changing physical and chemical environments of the circulating hydrothermal fluid. Ideally, this forms a core of massive pyrite and chalcopyrite around the throat of the vent system, with a halo of chalcopyrite, sphalerite, pyrite grading into distal sphalerite galena and galena manganese, and finally a short manganese hematite facies. Most VMS deposits show a vertical zonation of gold, with the cooler upper portions generally more enriched in gold and silver. The mineralogy of VMS deposits consists of over 90% iron sulfide, mainly in the form of pyrite, with chalcopyrite, sphalerite, and galena also being major constituents. Magnetite is present in minor amounts. As magnetite content increases, the ores grade into massive oxide deposits. The gangway is mainly quartz and pyrite or pyroitite. Thank you for listening. This is the end of part 1. Photo information will be specifically discussed by following reporters.
Hi everyone, I am the second reporter from our group, and I will be continuing our report about VMS deposits. VMS deposits are dominated by copper and zinc, but there are a number of other minor minerals, including lead, silver, gold, cobalt, tin, selenium, magnesium, cadmium, and a whole host of other ones that are associated with them. VMS deposits with copper and zinc are hosted by sequences dominated by mafic volcanic rocks and are particularly abundant with Archean and Paleoproterozoic greenstone belts. VMS deposits with zinc, lead, copper occur in sequences dominated by felsic volcanic rocks, sourced from continental crust, and are best exemplified by the Kuroko deposits of the Miocene Green Tuff Belt of Japan. Iron-rich sulfides occur predominantly with basalts, whereas copper, iron, zinc appear in volcanic terrains of andesite, dacites, and iron, lead, zinc with rhyolites. Water isotope data suggests that the hydrothermal solutions are mainly altered seawater. Therefore, VHMS ore deposits are thought to result from seawater convection and hydrothermal dissolution of minerals from volcanic rocks. In this slide is the generalized section of VMS Kuroko type ore deposit. Among the submarine exhalative VMS deposits, Kuroko ore deposits are an economically significant subtype, and the term Kuroko is derived from the black lead zinc ore that was exploited in Japan for centuries. Early fine-grained ores of zinc sulfide, lead sulfide, pyrite, and barite were formed during extrusion of rhyolite domes by hydrothermal acceleration through submarine vents and mound building on the seafloor. So in this figure, white spaces are zones of hydrothermal sedimentary sulfide ore of copper, lead, and zinc, some of which was seen genetically altered and recrystallized. The pyrite-rich stockwork of copper is centered below the former. The early ore muds were altered by reaction with upward percolating hot fluids that produce stockwork veinlets with coarse pyrite, chalcopyrite, and quartz. The deposits consist of a massive sulfide cap that formed on the seafloor and sort of lies parallel between two stratigraphy and an underlying feeder zone or streamer zone, as it is usually called. VMS is basically mushroom shaped. So streamer zone tends to be the copper rich than zinc rich. VMS deposits often form as clusters over large intrusive heat source. If the heat chamber is long-lived, you may get flat lenses of massive sulfide, each fed from the same fault, beginning successively younger as you grow up through the stratigraphy. The deposits are pretty common, although, as with any deposit type, there are only few big enough or high enough grade to be economic. VMS deposits have been forming throughout geological history, and they are still forming on the seafloor today. Here's a bunch of a better known deposits you may heard of. This is a Harton 3D view of an active VMS black smoker developing on the oceanic crust on the seafloor. Some of the metals are contributed by the underlying magma chamber, but as the hydrothermal fluids rise above the hot magma, it sucks in cool seawater. This is then heated and mixing with the magmatic water, rises to the vent, returning to the sea, forming a large circulation cells that may be several kilometers across. It is the seawater circulation through the host volcanic that provides the remainder of the metal inputs. Metal concentration in the hydrothermal fluids, volcanic, and recycled seawater are really low, just fractions of a percent. So how do we end up with an ore that makes up 20 to 30% metal? The next slide on the seafloor to explain this, you can see that there is a neck of fractured rock below the seafloor, caused by a violent boiling of the hot fluids as the pressure is reduced. That in turn is surmounted by a series of chimneys that allow the fluid escape into the cold sea. At the bottom of the thermic line is very, very cold, so it is often a few degrees above freezing, even in the tropical areas. Surrounding the chimney is an exhalative length of sulfuric mineral or material that forms on the floor. The secret of the high-grade ore lies in the rapid cooling of the hydrothermal fluid when it reaches the floors. I mean full seafloor. As in periphery deposits, the main focus of trend in deposits is the drop in temperature rather than the changes in EH or pH. Different metal sulfides tend to drop out a metal solution at different temperatures. Copper and gold first, followed by zinc, then lead, and finally iron. There is an overlap in the metal deposition, but that's a broad trend. Copper starts to drop out first as the temperature starts to drop from 400 degrees Celsius down to 300 degrees. And the iron drops out before the fluids actually reach the seafloor. Precipitating is a stockwork of veins in the brecciated funnel, also called stringer zone, beneath the sulfide lens. The fluids are hot, and because they are from a high sulfidation source, they are moderately acid. This acidity alters the feldspar and host rocks to clays, some of which are washed out from the rock, and others metamorphose form sericite mica. Dissolved silica in hot solutions distributes deposits such as quartz along with iron sulfide. You may hear geologists referring to this characteristic leach quartz sericite pyrite assemblage. The results are either QSP or folic alteration. As hydrothermal fluids reach the seawater, the temperature drops within seconds from 300 degrees down to 100 degrees and less. The lead and the zinc sulfide precipitates along with the remainder of copper. The sulfide dissolves along the sides and at the top of the vents, extending them and then below, out to form a black and white smoke as you see in some National Geographic pictures. The fine clouds of sulfide goes and settles on the seafloor, building up a finely banded layers of pure sulfate, which are closest to the vent, galena and sphalerite next. Pyrite deposits throughout the sequence and most desolate from the bed, that is the only sphalerite still available to deposit. Beyond that, the sulfur is exhausted and iron oxide or hematite and silica is all that is left to precipitate. The massive sulfide is made up of a combination of finely interbedded sulfide that settle out of the black smokers and fragments of chimneys that are broken off and rolled down the slope. Here are a couple of shots of massive sulfides in outcrop. Note the typical fine rhythmic banding just below the hammer on the left-hand photo. The photo on the bottom right shows abandoned iron formation developed very distantly to a VMS vent. As you can see, it is made up of hematite or magnetite, which is oxide rather than sulfide and white silica. In the next slide here, we see the average volcanogenic massive sulfide ore deposit grades with 5% copper, 4% zinc, less than 1% lead, maybe 1 gram per ton of gold. And again, there are a few outlines with far higher grades than this. VMS deposits have been forming since the earliest times in the Earth's history, and they are still forming today on the seafloor. As you might expect, they are found all over the world and in all ages of rocks. However, there are a few areas in history where they seem to be particularly prevalent. The late Archean and Tertiary seems to be very prolific times. Okay, so what about size and grade? There are a number of different classes of VMS, each with somewhat very different characteristics, which will be discussed by the succeeding reporters of our topic. Thank you.
Greetings everyone, my name is Cyril Villacote, and at this part I'm going to report about the bimodal mafic dominated flow. So the setting at which this forms is in an ocean-to-ocean arc, nascent arc rifting. The median size and composition is about 2.8 Mt, 1.4 to 1 copper, 2.6 zinc, 0.1 lead, 0.8 of gold, and 22 of silver. As to its geology, it is comprised of 75% paleothiolitic basalt andesite, less than 25% sodium felsic flows, flow breccia, endogenous domes, minor pyroclastic sediment, and minor tufite. It also has some felsic subvolcanic intrusions prominent at 3 to times 20 kilometers. As to its ores, there are identified massive sulfide bulbous to tubular pyritic astatine, siborgium or antimony, minor of tin, variable, prominent of copper stringer zones, pipe alteration, pronounced zone of iron to magnesium chloride core, sericerite rim, and quartz sulfide veins. It is semi-conformable epitode albite to actinolite, overlain by the silification, irregular metal depletion. Examples of these are the Noranda, Matagami, Snow Lake, Norwegian, and the Chalcedonides. So let's proceed to the first example, which is the Noranda cross section. So in this part, you would see the Flavian or the Flavrian block. We have identified synvolcanic dikes. Those that are labeled with or annotated with the color green are andesitic, and those that are annotated with yellow marks are rhyolitic. We also have identified the Sin Volcanic Floats in this cross-section, the Hunter Creek Fault, the Voss Creek Fault, the Bochastel Fault, the Horn Creek Fault, the Cranston Fault, and the Quesabe Fault, and the Bancroft Fault. Also, here in the diagram or in the picture, we can see the VMS deposits from the Ansel, the AN Ansel, the VC Voss, to the Delbridge. Now let's take a look at this another photo, the bimodal mafic dominated setting. We can see that it is 25% less than more than 25% felsic strata, with many shallow intrusions, flow domes, and no pyroclastics. The horn is anomalous because it is formed either outside a calderon or on its margin, and it has more sediment to have it precipitated. Next is the Kid Creek. Let's take a look at this Kid Creek versus Potter Mine. We would see the contrasting setting on the same greenstone belt, both with strong ultramafic volcanic association. Kid Creek has a unique setting, type 1B, and Potter Creek is Beshe ophiolite style, type 1A. Now, let's have a look at this Noranda type deposit. Sulfide mount form on the seafloor are zinc to copper, low in gold. Many with FS porphyry dikes in F fieldwork occupy the Sin Volcanic Fault. Several are in felsic cryptodomes, some detrital talus sulfide on margin, very vertically extensive stringer alteration zone, chlorite quartz core, sericerite outer margin.
Hello, I am Antoinette Kate Supanilag. So for today, I am going to talk about the lithotectonic type mafic. So as you can see here in the picture, we have the setting, which is a mature intraoceanic back arc. So its tectonic setting is intraoceanic back arc setting, since correspondingly, intraoceanic arc system crust is thinner and more mafic than that beneath Andean type arcs, which is thicker and more felsic. So intraoceanic arc system consists of these four components. We have the trench, the fore arc, the magmatic arc, and we have the back arc basin. So trench is where two convergent plates meet, because one plate bends down to slide beneath the other. So they are several thousands of meters deeper than the sea floor away from the trench. So next we have is the fore arc, which is the lithosphere that lies between the trench and the magmatic arc, and it is generally 100 to 200 kilometer wide. And next we have is the magmatic arc, which is recognized in modern intraoceanic arc system as a linear or accurate array of volcanoes that parallel the trench. These are the largest and the most productive volcanoes in mature intraoceanic arc system, and are only the feature that rises above sea level. So next we have this average size composition, massive ore form and composition, and the geology. So first we have the average size and composition. So mafic are related to ocean subduction. So volcanic rocks dominate this type. We have also included mid-oceanic ridges, VMS setting in mafic type, as the deposits are virtually identical to those in the mafic dominated mature back arc setting, except for petrochemicals attributes. So for some observation about the grade and size of deposits are, The mafic pipes display slightly higher copper and distinctly higher gold contents, but significantly lower zinc contents. Also, the lead contents of the two felsic-dominated types are much higher than in the mafic-dominated types. And last, the volcanic-dominated types are similar in size, although the deposits in mafic types characterized by those in ophiolite terrains are significantly smaller. So, in this mafic massive ore form and composition, we have Bobos. Aspect ratio is 1:2, copper-zinc, more gold-rich, coarse grain, and some are zone. For the geology, we have tholeitic, MORB to LILE and LREE, enriched ocean island basalt. So here in the figure is a simplified ophiolite sequence, which is an example of a mafic type of lithologenic. Troodos ophiolite sequence consists of peridotite and associated ultramafic rocks, which are dense, coarse-grained igneous rocks predominantly composed of the greenish mineral olivine. So Troodos ophiolite is Cyprus is the principal on-land analog for mafic-hosted volcanogenic massive sulfide deposits. So these rocks comprise Earth's mantle, and above lies a section of layered gabbro, the intrusive equivalent to basalt. This is overlain by unlayered gabbro. Both types form the underground injection and slow cooling of iron and magnesium-rich magma into surrounding rocks. Above the gabbro lies a complex of sheeted dikes, which is particularly exposed on Cyprus. Here is a large copper mine on the island of Cyprus. So this mineral deposit is located within a piece of oceanic crust that have been thrust up or uplifted on an island by the collision of tectonic plates. Such deposits provide early evidence for the existence of mineral deposits and hydrothermal vents on the seafloor. And as early as 3000 BC, people mined copper from massive ore deposits on the island of Cyprus. The fact that these massive sulfide deposits are straight upon within the pillar lava sections of the ophiolite sequence indicates that they probably form within the ocean basins and that they are related to volcanogenic processes at spreading centers. Differentiation of mafic and ultramafic magmas deep within spreading centers are also concentrate chromite minor sulfides, and these processes are equally important to the formation of ore deposits within oceanic crust. Cyprus type deposits are hosted by submarine mafic volcanic rocks and their altered equivalents, typically imbricated rocks commonly associated with pillow lavas, which have good buffering capacity. That's all. Thank you.
Hello, I am Henton Aliviu, and this next topic is about the Pilitic mafic back arc type. Pilite, meaning a very fine grained sediment or sedimentary rock composed of clay or mud particles. A Pilitic mafic back arc type has a setting of a mature oceanic back arc. The average size of the deposit is usually 4.7 metric tons, and having a composition of 1.2% copper, 1.6% zinc, 0.7% lead, and 0.75 gram per ton gold and 19 gram per ton silver. Having a lithological units of basalt and pilite subequal or pilite dominant, with mafic seals up to 25% of the succession, felsic volcanic rocks, volcaniclastic seals, flow, and or domes are absent or less than 5%, and sediments include carbonaceous argillite, subordinate siltstone, wacke, and sandstone. Now we have here a cross-section example of this type. as you can see the deposition, then the lamination of argillite and shale, then the basalt seal or flow, next again the argillite and shale, then the basalt seal and flow, and so on. This example is much bigger compared to the average size. It has 11 metric tons. 1.4% of that is copper, 2.5% zinc, 1.7 lead, and 19 gram per ton silver, and less than 1 gram per ton gold. This is a lithostratigraphic section example of the Windy Craggy deposit in British Columbia. This supergiant deposit occurs with a successor extensional basin dominated by argillite, carbonaceous argillite, marl, and carbonate units. Basalt flows and syn volcanic seal complexes intercalated with carbonaceous argillite dominated the middle to upper part of this succession and host the massive sulfide mineralization. The surface to subsurface volcanic edifice consisting of numerous basalt seals and flows emplaced into argillite and carbonaceous argillite with a more restricted, deeper water sedimentary basin. So to sum it all up, P-lite mafic settings occur in mature oceanic back arcs typified by sub-equal amounts of P-lite and basalt, including mafic seals. That would be all for my part. Thank you.
Hello, good day everyone. My name is Kristen Rose Ambular-Pilar and I will be the sixth reporter of this group's topic, which I will be discussing about the bimodal felsic-dominated volcanic arc, which is a type of formation from the volcanic massive sulfide deposits.
So what is a bimodal felsic-dominated volcanic arc? There are ocean continent supersubduction arc that are flow-dominated with sub-volcanic intrusions, with the following attributes or characteristics, which includes the setting, which is ocean continent arc, and nascent or rising arc rifting. The average size and composition, which is 3.4 metric ton, that is 1.0% copper, 4.4% zinc, 1.1% lead, 1.1 grams per ton gold, and 56 grams per ton silver. The geology is less than 65% sodium-potassium felsic pyroclastic strata, endogenous domes, sediment minor, which includes tuffite, that are volcaniclastic rocks and sediments, which includes or consists of between 25% and 75% by volume of pyroclastic fragments. And then more than 35% pyrophthalatic to calc alkaline andesite. Felsic subvolcanic intrusions, not prominent. The ore are massive sulfides, bulbous to tabular form, pyritic, arsenic, antimony, tin variable, some gold-rich local late high suture or strain zones, and limited copper stringer zones. The pipe alteration is pronounced, silicification and sericite dominant, zoned iron magnesium chloride core, and sericite rim. This deposit is semi-conformable, which is lower albitic or albitic, upper potassium feldspar rich, sodium depleted, and uppermost zoned iron carbonate.
This type of deposit includes examples, which is for one, Kuroko, which is located within the eastern marginal rift zone or Kuroko rift that formed in the final period of back arc rifting of Japan, which are known for its copper and zinc bearing massive sulfide deposits and marine volcanic rocks of intermediate to felsic composition. Second is Skellefte, which is located in northern Sweden, are host to abundant volcanogenic massive sulfide deposits comprising pyritic, massive, semi-massive, and disseminated zinc, copper, gold, lead ore surrounded by disseminated pyrite. The third is Butchins, located in the central part of the island of Newfoundland in Canada. The Butchins ore bodies are known by their polymetallic stratiform massive volcanogenic sulfide deposits, which exhibit numerous similarities to the Kuroko deposits of Japan. Sturgeon Lake, which is a lake in the Kawartha Lakes region of Ontario, Canada, which this district exploited a number of Archean volcanic-hosted massive sulfide zinc-copper deposits. Buttle Lake, or Buttle Lake, is a lake on Vancouver Island in Strathcona Regional District, British Columbia, Canada, which these ore deposits are complexly metal-zoned volcanogenic massive sulfides of Devonian age, hosted in the Mira or Mira formation of the Sikargu volcanic assemblage. So this illustration is a descriptive model showing a bimodal felsic-dominated volcanic arc of the VMS zone. This illustration shows the legendary from colors of shaded gray, which includes a composition of the sericite quartz, chlorite sericite, quartz chlorite, chalcopyrite pyrite veins. Under detrital is the pyrite sphalerite galena tetrahedrite silver gold. Under massive is the pyrite sphalerite galena, pyrite sphalerite chalcopyrite, chalcopyrite pyrotite pyrite, and then birite gold, carbonate, or gypsum. So this is another illustration showing the descriptive model of a high sulfidation volcanic massive sulfide deposit. As you can see here, the deposit is under a shale or argillite rock body and is composed primarily or surrounded primarily by felsic or clastic bodies. And in the lower part of the body or the lower part of this sulfide deposit is surrounded by felsic lava dome. So under this illustration is the legendary, which includes shades of colors that includes the compositions from quartz sericite aluminum silicate, the sericite quartz pyrite, real cinnabar stibnite, arsenopyrite stibnite tetrahedrite lead, and quartz pyrite, arsenopyrite, sphalerite, galena tetrahedrite veins, in which the real cinnabar stibnite and arsenopyrite stibnite tetrahedrite lead are part of the infilling and replacement. So there are two types of bimodal felsic dominated class, and these are a special case of the bimodal felsic dominated class, which includes the unusual compositions and the unusually enriched and high volatility elements, in which the unusual compositions, which is found in Boliden, Nevis, Corvo, which are possible direct magmatic input. It shows that there are high mercury, tin, and tellurium, and unusual non-stratiform shapes, and not high stringer or suture. The second is the unusually enriched and high volatility elements, which includes mercury, antimony, arsenic, and sulfur. Their probable exceptionally high vapor phase of boiling systems, and as well as the unusual compositions, they are not really high suture or stringer either. So that would be all for my report. Thank you for listening.
Hello everyone, I am Aloha Jane Ohario and today I am going to report the last type of volcanic massive sulfide, the felsic siliciclastic. The felsic siliciclastic hosted setting is that it is in the mature ocean continent buff arc. The average size and composition is that 7.1 metric tons and 0.6 of copper, 2.7 zinc, 1.1 lead, 0.6 grams per ton of gold, and 38 grams per ton of silver. The geology is that it is in a siliciclastic volcanic continent-derived sediments. Locally prominent felsic pyroclastic flows, minor calc-alkaline mafic flows. The ores are in massive sulfide huge tabular, pyrite and pyrotite, variable arsenic, antimony, tin, and minor copper stringer zones, and some with chert. The figure in the screen is a schematic composite section through a VMS alteration system in the Vatorst mining camp. The most notable example of a felsic siliciclastic hosted VMS is the Vatorst mining camp, which is a sedimented Buck Arc continental rift basin. Here, you can see the arc continuously matures and then consequently dominated by felsic volcaniclastics and volcano sedimentary rocks with very discrete intrusions and extrusions of mafic and felsic magma. The term siliciclastic felsic to felsic siliciclastic is because of the abundance of volcaniclastic and epiclastic sediment relative to felsic volcanic rocks in this group of deposits. That would be all for our report. Thank you very much for listening.